Welcome back to Computer Organization course. Today we will study about stack data structure and its operations. Before studying stack concept, we should know some basic concepts so that we can understand stack very easily. I have listed three different basic concepts you must go through in my previous videos so that you can understand stack and their operations. You must have knowledge of what is memory and how memory addressing is done. This is I have explained in my previous video, memory and byte addressing. Similarly, you must go through my one more video, addressing modes, to understand what is index addressing mode and what is indirect addressing mode. So in indirect addressing modes, you should know how to implement it using a register. Also, auto increment and auto decrement addressing modes are used in the stack. So please go through the previous video, addressing modes. The one more basic concept you should know to understand operations of stack is compare instruction. How compare instruction works and how branching is done based on the result of compare instruction. For this purpose, I have explained compare instruction and branching in a separate video, which you have to watch before watching this session. So please go through all the previous videos which you require to understand the stack operations and then start this session. Stack is the most important data structure in computer science. Every subject makes use of stack, every concept makes use of stack. You read stack in different subject, in different manner, in different perspective. Already you might know what is stack and how it works, and you might have studied it in data structure subject. Here we discuss stack in the perspective of actual memory. In data structure subject, the stack you discuss is interpreted by C language. The difference I will study at the end of the session. Now here we will study what is stack and their operations. So stack is a linear data structure. What is meaning of linear? Means it is straight line. Or in terms of memory, I can say stack is a consecutive memory allocated. So linear data structure means the stack has consecutive memories. Means address of every cell inside the stack, okay, are continuous. Now what is a cell? See, if this is a stack, then every item it can store is called a cell. The memory, every memory item, it's called cell. For example, here in this stack, I have all 8 cells. That means I can store 8 different information or 8 items in the stack. It is also called capacity of the stack or the size of the stack. So here in this, my size of the stack is 8 items, where already 4 items I have filled. Now, how to store an item in the stack? Suppose I want to store an item, I'll simply store it here, 10H. So storing some data inside the stack, a single item, is called push. Push means adding an element or item to the collection of the stack or collection of items in the stack. It is called push. Push means storing only one item. You want to store one more item, you have to make one more push operation. So this is how stack push operation works. Now what is a pop operation here? Pop operation means removing the item from the stack. We don't require it, so we'll remove it from the stack and use it in some other instruction in the program. So removing a particular item from the stack is called pop. Now you might have a doubt. See, stack looks like a memory, continuous memory. Storing and removing item from the memory is also possible. So what is the difference between a regular memory and a stack? There is a difference between storing data and removing data from a regular memory and stack. That means the push operation and pop operation are not simply storing or removing. There are some restrictions in the push and pop operation. that what makes stack different than regular memory. What are those restrictions in push and pop operation of the stack? See, while pushing some element, that is while storing a new item in the stack, you have to store at the top of the stack only. Now what is the top of the stack? See, this is the bottom of the stack, that is the first element here. This cell is called bottom of the stack. And you may call this as the top, but what actually top element is nothing but the top here, the first empty space available in the stack. That means, see here in this stack, already there are four items. So this is the bottom of the stack, that is 10H item is at the bottom of the stack. And what is the top is first empty cell available. That is means up to four elements are filled. So the fifth cell is empty. So this is the top of the stack. Now whenever you have to store some data, I cannot store it in this cell of the stack. Why? Every time you push a new element, it must be stored in the first empty cell available in the stack. That is, you have to push at the top here only. Once this is filled, so once this place is filled, now you can push one more element here. Because this is the empty space, first empty space available. So stack must be filled, right, in the top element only, top space only. Okay, we cannot randomly push some elements in the stack. Similarly, for pop operation also, whenever you have to remove an element or item from the stack, you should remove topmost element present in the stack. Here there are four elements in the stack. Topmost element is 48H. You have to remove that element only. You have to remove pop 48H only. So what if I want to pop 33H? That means you have to pop 48H first. Then this state becomes empty. Now 33H becomes topmost element. Now you can pop 33H. So pop means you are removing a single element. That has to be done from the topmost element only. So these two are the restrictions that stack have in push and pop operation. That what makes stacks is different than a regular memory where you can store data in any random address and remove data from any random address. Before studying the stack implementation inside the memory, let us see how exactly memory we can store data in the memory, or how can we access data from the memory using indirect addressing. I have explained indirect addressing in previous addressing mode videos. Please go through it. Here, see, there is a register called SP. This is a any other register like R0, R1, R2. There is a register called SP, and it holds an address of a particular location 1239H. That means in the memory, it holds address of this particular byte. I want to store some value into this byte. So how can I refer the address of 1239H using the name of the SP register? That is called indirect addressing using SP. See, I have written the statement here. I want to move an immediate data 10H to this here. So after executing this instruction, you can see 10H at the 1239H. Why? Because SP is used as an indirect register. It is written inside the square bracket. That means when you write some register name inside the square bracket, that value 10H is not stored in that register. Instead, that whatever the content of the register is there, it is considered as the address, and processor takes the data you have given to that address and store it in that particular location. If there was no square brackets right around SP register here, that time processor would have copied this 10H value inside the SP register. But this is now within the square bracket, so it is called register indirect addressing. Similarly, how can I access a particular data from the memory? See, suppose I want to access 1239H address, that value I want to access and store it in R3 register. Then I store that address is in SP and I use that SP as a source within square brackets. So processor go to SP for initially, finds out whatever the value is there, consider it as an address, go to that particular location in the memory, fetch whatever the data present in that byte and copy it to the R3 register, which is nothing but destination. So this is how register indirect addressing works. But this is in the memory. Means in any random address you can store data or you can access the data from any random address. But how exactly it is different than stack? Now look at the stack. Now let us see what is a stack in memory. See, stack is not a separate hardware to store data like any register. Stack here is part of the memory. Stack is a theoretical concept and it restricts the way memory can be accessed or stored. So that theoretical concept is implemented by making use of regular memory. So what is actually stack? See, stack is actually we are declaring a part of the memory as stack. Here I have declared a 8 byte memory in a big memory. The 8 bytes I have considered it as a stack. And you can see they are continuous bytes from 1241H until 1248H. 8 bytes, continuous bytes, I have considered it as a stack. So stack is a part of the memory and all bytes must be continuous. Now what is the size of the stack? It is 8 bytes. You can see here. The size of the stack is 8 byte and here I have considered every cell as 1 byte. That means I can store 8 different items in stack. And you can see that every item must be 1 byte. Correct, no? Every item must be 1 byte. And I can store such 8 items. So I have declared 8 byte stack. So whenever somebody asks what is the size of the stack, you can say either 8 byte stack or you can say 8 different items of 1 byte each. Okay, now what is the SP register? See, SP register is not a general purpose register like R0, R1, R2. It is a specific purpose register like IR. It is used to store instruction like MAR. It is used to store address. Similarly, the SP register is called stack pointer. And it is nothing but it simply points to the topmost element present in the stack. Because we can push an element on the top of topmost element or you can pop topmost element present in the stack. So we should know what is the last element pushed in the stack. So here SP is a register which holds the last element address or last item address that is pushed into the stack. Using SP, using indirect addressing mode, I can push a new value or I can pop out the last pushed value, that is topmost element from the stack. For example, if there are two elements in the stack already here, there are two elements, first 2 bytes stack already here, then stack pointer will be pointing to this. The value of stack pointer is 1247H. Because it always points to topmost element. If stack has 4 elements, then stack SP would be pointing 1245H. The value of SP is nothing but 1245H. So whenever you have to push something, like I want to store one more item, the rule is that you have to store here only, the right first empty location or topmost value. So whenever I have to store here, what I have to do? I have to manually increment SP. Sorry, I have to update SP to 1244 and store data here. So that after storing the item here, SP will be pointing to the last element pushed or topmost element. I want to store one more element. Yeah, update SP to this address and store data in that particular item using SP as the indirect register. So whenever you want to pop, what is the rule? To pop an element or to remove element from the stack, rule is that you have to remove topmost element only. So here these elements are there and topmost element is this. And we know that SP always points to the topmost element. So using SP we can access this. And once it is removed and once we pop out the topmost element, once it is removed, we must update stack pointer to the next element present. We have to update the stack pointer. So whenever you push some element, you have to update the stack pointer whenever you pop out some element, you have to update the stack pointer again. So this is how stack pointer and a stack works. Now let us see how push and pop operation works, okay, in the programmatic perspective. So before studying push and pop operation and their implementation using assembly language or in any language, let us get familiar with some of the stack terminologies. Now we know what is stack, what is the size of the stack, what is stack pointer, which is nothing but points to the topmost element present in the stack. What are other some terminology we must know? The initial first one is stack boundary. What is stack boundary? Stack boundary is nothing but the address where stack begins and the address where stack ends. Here the lower boundary of the stack, or the stack begins at 1248H. That is the one boundary, and one more boundary where stack ends is 1241H. Okay, and we should know that, I just forgot to explain, stack is always right filled vertically like this. Means we keep filling bottom data first and then we keep moving towards the top. I had explained this. This is the bottom and this is the top. Okay. So stack boundary is nothing but 1248H is the bottom and 1241H is the top element address. Now what is stack full? It is a condition, stack full condition. So this is actually can be defined using the boundary. See, from the bottom boundary, we keep filling data in the stack, that is pushing data one by one. As we push data, we should update SP also. Now I push one more element, so SP will be pointing here. So if I push more elements and fill the stack, where SP will be pointing? SP will be pointing to the top boundary. Why? Stack is completely filled. So this condition where all the items in the stack are filled and SP is pointing to the topmost boundary, it is called stack full condition. Now what is the overflow? It is a situation where stack is already filled completely and you are trying to push one more element. You can see here, here the topmost element, stack is completely filled. When I try to push one more element, the element or item will be pushed out of the stack, right? This is my stack boundary, 1241H. The now new item will go to the memory which is out of the stack. Stack is completely filled, new item is going beyond the stack area. You cannot do this because we have defined the stack size and memory in the a particular area in the memory. Now you cannot make stack operation beyond that addresses. So this situation is called stack overflow. Means SP now points here. When you push a new data, SP will be pointing to this address. Stack is completely filled and new item is pushed out of the stack. SP is pointing out of the stack. This is called overflow condition, overflow situation. This situation happens when stack is filled completely and you are trying to push a new item. Now overflow should not happen. It is your responsibility to take care of that there is no overflow in the stack. So SP should not point to beyond the stack. The maximum value SP should point is nothing but the top boundary of the stack. We will see how to handle this situation of overflow later. So the overflow means stack is already filled and a new item we are pushing which go beyond the stack. It is called overflow. Now what is stack empty? Stack empty is nothing but there are no item at all. See, if there is only one, for example, two items in the stack, where SP would point? SP would point to this address, 1247H. That is, the SP value will be 1247H. Why? There are two items and SP always points to the topmost element present. If the three elements were there, SP would point to 1246H. Imagine there is only one element. And where would SP point to? SP points to the bottom boundary of the stack. Correct, no? If there is only one element, SP would point to 1248H. That is the SP is pointing to the topmost element, only one element present, so that element itself is the topmost element. Fine. Now, if I pop out this element also, if I remove this element also, then where would SP point? Now, SP actually points to the address below the bottom boundary of the stack. Now, stack empty is nothing but all the no elements present in the stack. Stack is completely empty. So, SP starts pointing to the address below the bottom of the stack. And this is not an error. This is not an error. This is a condition. Okay. So, empty, whenever stack is empty, you can see here initially, see in this condition. Look at the value of the SP. SP is 1249H. Why SP is pointing to 1249H? Because stack is empty. There is no even single element. If there is at least one element, SP would point to its address 1248H. Okay. Whenever stack empty, SP would point to the address below the bottom of the stack. This is called stack empty, empty situation. This is not any error. Now, what is the situation called underflow? Underflow is nothing but stack is already completely empty and SP would point to 1249H, which is below the bottom of the stack, and yet you are trying to pop out some element. You are trying to remove some element from the stack, but stack is already empty. That means what happens is actually you try to remove an element from the 1249H. Because which element you always remove? We remove topmost element. That is nothing but we remove element which is pointed by the SP, stack pointer. Now, during the empty stack, SP would point to 1249H. And if you try to remove, when stack is empty, if you try to remove an element, you are actually removing data from this particular address, which is not part of your stack. As I told you earlier, you cannot make any stack operations beyond the stack area. So this situation is called underflow, and this should not also be happen. That means whenever you pop out some element, you must see whether stack is empty. If stack is empty, you should not make pop operation. Similarly, what is overflow? Whenever you try to push some value into the stack, you should see whether stack is already full. If stack is already full, you should not push any more elements and should not make any overflow. So these two things you should know, overflow and underflow. Now let us see how push and pop operation can be implemented. Now let us see push operation in details and try to implement using assembly language. So we know already what is push operation. For example, push operation is nothing but storing a new data in the stack. For example, let us assume that there is three elements in the stack here. So where will be my stack pointer pointing to? The stack pointer value would be 1246H. Why? Because there are three elements at 1248H, 1247H and 1246H. I told you push operation, the direction of push operation is like this, from bottom to top. And the pop operation direction is from top to bottom. So since there are three items already present in the stack, thus my SP pointer will be pointing to 1246H. Now let us see what is push operation. I want to push a data 10H into this item, into this stack. So how to push a new item 10H into the stack? I have to push at this location. But I don't know address of this location. How to get the address of the new top where I have to push a new element? That is very simple. I know that my SP would be pointing to the topmost element present, 1246H. I want to push a new data on the above that top element. So that its address is here 1245H. That means if you decrement SP value, SP value start pointing to the new top. And using SP as indirect register, you push that 10H into the new top. Now let us try to push one more element. For example, 20H. into the stack. What is the push operation restriction? That we have to push the new value into the first vacant element present in the stack. Empty byte yavudu ide adralle push madbeku. So here there are already four elements. So next right immediate empty value is 1244H. I have to push my new value here only. Now how to push it? 1245H, this is the SP currently pointing to the topmost element. You decrement SP to 1244H and use SP value as the indirect register and push that 20H to SP. That is using move, right? So move 20H to SP within square bracket. That means SP is decremented already. So it is 1244H. Your 20H will be transferred to this location. And SP is anyhow updated by decrementing. So I think you have observed this push operation clearly, that how push operation has to be implemented. Decrement SP and use that SP as the indirect addressing mode and push the new item into the address located by the SP. So this is how push operation works. Let us see how to write this in assembly language. This is the assembly language code. See, whenever I have to push something, a new item, initially I subtract SP by 1. Correct, no? So 1244H, if I want to push a new item, I have to make SP value as 1243H. So subtract SP value by 1 and use that SP as indirect register in indirect addressing mode and give your new value. For example, I will make it 30H. If this is I want to push 30H. So move hash 30H to the SP content. That is nothing but decrement SP initially works. SP points to 1243H now and your 30H will be moved to here. So these are the two lines together called push operation. Now let us see how to handle overflow and underflow situation during push operation. Let us initially see underflow situation. We'll handle underflow situation first. So what is underflow situation? See, you can see here, my entire stack here is empty. There is no element at all. So where SP would point? SP points to the 1249H. Correct, no? When stack is completely empty. Now, there will be no underflow if I put in push operation. Why? If stack is empty and I have to push a new item, what happens? SP is decremented first. So SP is 1249H. Now SP becomes 1248H. In that new location, I will move a item, push item into the stack. So the item will be here. Correct, no? So there is one item now and SP is pointing to that item. That is the topmost item. So according to our definition of stack, it is 100% correct. So whenever there is an empty stack is empty and you try to push a new item, it works perfectly. There is no issue at all. Okay. Now empty stack is empty. There will be no underflow when we make push operation. That's we studied right now. But what happens when stack is full? Let us see that first. Here you can see the entire stack is completely filled here. Correct, no? There are all the elements filled in all these bytes one by one. And stack pointer is pointing to the topmost element present. But stack is completely filled. Now we try to push. Let us see what happens. I want to push some new item. I decrement SP. So SP is 1241H. When I decrement, SP go to 1240H. And I push my new item in next instruction to that particular address. So my new item, for example, 10H will be here. You can see when stack is empty and at you push a new item, you are making some operation beyond the stack region. This is not allowed. Here overflow happened. Here overflow happened, I did not handle it. So how to handle the overflow condition? See, when there is no stack is not filled, this our code what we have written works perfect. When stack is empty, this code works perfect. But when stack is already filled, this code won't work properly. We have to handle the pushing when stack is already filled. That means we should not push any element when stack is already filled. What we have to do when user try to push a new element when stack is already filled, you have to give an error message saying that stack is filled, we cannot push any element, and reject that proposal. So how to do that using program? So I have made a small change in my code to handle overflow situation. So that overflow never happens. When stack is already filled, see, you can see here all the elements, stack is completely filled. Stack pointer will be pointing to here 1241H, correct? No, that is the maximum boundary of the stack, top value. Now if I make and push operation, I have handled this situation in my code. What I have done, see, I have explained you what is the boundary of the stack. So top boundary, I know address of the topmost element, that is the top boundary of the address stack, because I have declared the stack. So I should know the bottom boundary and top boundary addresses. So I know that 1241H is, here H is missing, okay, 1241H is the top address of the stack, maximum address possible. So I will compare my SP value with 1241H. Compare instruction is, I have explained very clearly, so I am making use of the compare and branch here. I am using compare and comparing whether SP value is 1241H, and if SP value is compared to 1241H, and I will make a branch if their comparison result, that is subtraction SP minus 1241H. You know how compare works. So SP minus 1241H, that difference is less than or equal to 0. That means stack is completely filled, we cannot make any push operation. So I will branch here to some label called full error. In that label I will write error message, printf error message, so that the bottom two line code does not execute. That means push, right, the pushing code doesn't work. So how exactly this code works, handles the situation? Because if SP value is equal to 1241H, and that means the topmost element, all data is filled, stack is completely filled, so SP would point to the late maximum boundary of the stack, 1241H. I'm comparing it with the actual boundary of the 1241H. If SP value is equal to 1241H as shown in this diagram, that time SP minus 1241H gives the difference result as 0. The value is 0. So if it is equal to 0, see, I have given is branch equal to 0, then I will go to full error condition. That means already it is, SP is here only. SP is at the topmost element itself. So we cannot insert anything. Why that less than or equal to we have checked? Even if by mistake we have pushed to some element, okay, and SP is pointing here also, this condition also, when I check 1241H, that is my maximum boundary with the SP value, that is 1240H. So 1240 minus 1241, I will get result negative value, 0 less. This should not happen. Okay, that's why I am writing the code, but simply they have written, it is enough if branch equal to 0. If you write branch equal to 0, it is enough. So this is my code to handle overflow situation. Now in this case, when stack is completely filled, it won't allow to execute push operation. Fine. Whether this code works in any other condition, like whether stack is empty or stack has some values and there is a space to push new element, whether this code works when stack is empty, or whether this code works when there is a space to push in the stack, that also works. You can check this, you can make a trial and error. Now let us see the pop operation, one more operation supported by the stack. So to understand this, let me assume that already there are three elements in the stack. So SP would point to 1246H. Okay. Now how to pop out an element, remove an element from the stack? There is a restriction to pop, that you should pop only topmost element present. Here there are three elements, so topmost element is this at address 1246H. you cannot remove any other element below 1246H. So how to pop this out? It is very simple. See, I will write this code. Here, I am using SP as an indirect register. SP would point to the topmost element 1246H and I am moving that data to my one of the variable, or you can store it in register wherever you want. So what happened? This particular data will be copied to this location or register, whatever you have used. Now what I am doing is I am adding, incrementing SP value. SP is initially 1246. Now I am incrementing it by 1. What happens is SP starts pointing to 1247H. So this is how it looks like when there were 3 elements and top element was 1246H, but you popped it out. That time the top value, whatever value was present at the top of the stack, was removed and transferred to a destination. Then SP is decremented. So now SP is pointing to the top element again. Why? Because there are only 2 elements and this is a top element. SP is pointing to top element itself. So this is how we can make pop operation. But whether this code works in those two situations where underflow and overflow may happen, whether popping out works when stack is completely filled, whether the same code works when stack is empty, let us see. See here, I have taken example of a stack which is completely filled, and SP would point to the topmost element, that is nothing but 1241H. Now I want to pop out the element. That is nothing but topmost element only I have to pop out. That is the rule. So how it works? See, move the data present at SP address into a new item. Correct? No. So SP is pointing to the topmost element 1241H address. So I am copying that data and transferring it to the new item. That means that data will be removed from the stack. Okay. And it will be transferred to this location. Now SP is pointing to 1241H itself, but the data is here, it is not there, it is removed. So what I have to do, as soon as you pop out some element from the stack, you should make SP point to the new topmost element. What is the new topmost element here? Now this is a new topmost element. How to make SP point? SP is 1241, now you have to make SP 1242H, so increment it. So it will come to here. So your SP, you know, points to the new topmost element present. Correct? No. So when stack is full, our code what we have written here, it works perfectly. And it works at normally also it works when stack is half filled or some elements is filled. But the one more situation where stack is empty. Now let us see pop operation what we have written works when stack is empty. So here my entire stack is empty, completely empty, and stack pointer SP is pointing to 1249H address. This is empty situation I have already explained. Now let us see, I am trying to pop out a particular element. What happens? See, there will be some other elements in these memories. Memory is used by processor for various purpose. My stack, only stack region is empty. And when stack is empty, my SP will be pointing to the address below the bottom of the stack, 1249H. Now I am trying to pop out an element. What happens? I am using SP as an indirect address. From that location, I am copying data to from new location, like my register or any other locations. What happens? SP is pointing to 1249H, and there is some data here. That data will be copied to my destination. Is it allowed? It is not allowed. You cannot make any push or pop operation beyond the stack region. Okay. And it normally decrements SP, right? Next instruction executes. So SP will be pointing to incrementing the SP. So SP will be pointing to 1248H now. But this operation happening, it should not happen. Means it is underflown. Underflow situation happened. When stack is empty, we are trying to pop out, underflow situation happened. We should handle this underflow situation. We should not pop out any element when stack is empty. So how to do that? Let us look at the new code where we handle underflow situation. So here is the new code, and I hope I have handled underflow situation. So how? When stack is empty, we know that stack will be pointing to this right address below the bottom of the stack, that is 1249H. And I know the stack bottom is actually 1248H because I have declared the stack. I know its size and I know its boundary. So I am comparing initially, before popping out any element, I am comparing the stack bottom boundary to SP. See, in push operation, to handle overflow situation, I compare stack top boundary to the SP. Here in pop operation, to handle underflow situation, I am comparing stack bottom boundary with the SP value. So when stack is empty, SP is pointing actually 1249H, and we know that stack bottom boundary is 1248H. So I am comparing it. What happens now when actually stack is empty? SP is greater 1249H than stack boundary, that is 1248H. So destination minus source, that is how compare executes. Destination minus source gives a positive result. Why? SP is always greater than the bottom boundary of the stack when stack is empty. So when you subtract, the result is greater than 0. That means when you compare stack boundary with the SP as destination, then if the result obtained is greater than 0, that means SP is pointing to right empty condition. That means SP is pointing beyond the stack. Means stack is completely empty. Okay, when you compare bottom boundary with SP value and the result is greater than 0, actually it is empty. You cannot pop. So I will directly branch to some label in the program. In that label, I would write printf statement to the user. Stack is empty, we cannot pop any element, and we will display error message. So these two code, that is actually pop operation, right, won't execute when there is stack is empty. So I have handled underflow situation. Now whether this code works when actually there are some elements in the stack and I am trying to pop out the topmost element, or whether this code works when actually stack is completely filled and I am trying to pop out topmost element, definitely it works. In this condition, when stack is completely filled and I want to pop out topmost element, or stack is half filled where I want to pop out a topmost element, during those things, boundary is here 1248H and SP value will be right any other value other than 1249H. That means other than when stack is empty, means stack is not empty, either stack is filled or there are some elements, SP will be pointing to any address within stack. Okay, so our bottom boundary, when I compare, okay, SP would be pointing to any value, and when you subtract, boundary is greater and SP value is always less. SP value is always less. So when you subtract, in this case, okay, the branch that greater than 0 doesn't work. When SP is less and 1248 is great, the result is always less than 0, that is negative. So our branch, actually branching failed and pop operation works. Now you might have a doubt, what happens when there is only one element in the stack? Let us see that also. So see here, there is only one element in the stack and SP is pointing to that one element. That element itself is the topmost element. So now what happens? My boundary is also 1248H and my SP value is also 1248H. When comparison, the subtraction happens, difference is 0. But my condition, I am branching only when it is greater than 0. Very important. So what happens? Of course, this branch is failed. It is not greater than 0. It is not positive, neither negative, but it is 0. It is not greater than 0. Branch is failed. So my pop operation works. What happens? This 0 will be copied to the destination. This data will be copied to the destination and removed from the stack. Then next, what happens? Next, SP is added by 1. So 1248H, now SP will be 1249H. Because there was only one element, stack that is removed and SP is incremented. Now what happens when one element was there and it is removed, then it stack becomes empty. And when stack is empty, what is the situation? The same situation happened here, right? When stack is empty, SP will be pointing to the address below the bottom of the stack. Sir, everything is fine. So this is how push and pop operation works. And you must also know how to handle overflow situation during push operation and underflow situation during pop operation. Now let us see how to use auto increment and auto decrement addressing mode during push and pop operation. See, I have actual code here for push and pop. This is actual code we studied till now. You can see during push operation I am subtracting, and during pop operation I have to execute add instruction. Subtract and addition instruction has to be executed during push and pop. This instruction actually consumes more time to execute. Instead of that, we have increment and decrement instructions. Okay, that is very easy to execute when compared to add and subtract. Okay, why that is not discussed in your syllabus? So just you should know that increment and decrement instructions takes less time to execute. Subtract and add instruction takes more instruction, more time when compared. So as a programmer, we always should write efficient code which executes right in less time. So how to use auto increment, auto decrement addressing mode? Auto increment and auto decrement addressing mode is discussed in my previous addressing mode video. Please go through it. Here I can replace these two statements where subtract and then moving a new data into pushing new data into stack, as well as in the pop, right, popping out the data and updating SP, that is in adding SP or incrementing it by one. So how to replace these two statements? That is very simple. See, I have used in this auto increment and auto decrement. Okay, you can see this very clearly. So again, I'll show you here in this code. Okay, I am using auto decrement. Pre-decrement, very important, it is a pre-decrement, and initially subtraction has to be happen, then push should work, no? So pre-decrement I have written. How pop is written? Initially we copy data from the SP, right, address located by SP, then we add SP value so that it points to the new topmost element. So here it is post-increment, here pre-decrement and here post-increment. This is very important. Okay, I don't explain much here. Okay, you go through the auto increment decrement mode and try to understand this code. I have explained what is stack, its both operation, push operation, pop operation, how to handle two types of error, that is overflowing the stack during push operation or underflowing stack during pop operation. How to handle that is also explained. You can also make that code efficient by using auto increment decrement instead of subtract and addition instructions. I hope you have understood this very clearly. Now, throughout those examples, you might have seen I had declared a stack of 8 byte size where each cell or each item in the stack must be 1 byte. Right? 8 item could the stack, right, can store 8 items. Each item is 1 byte, so stack size was 8 byte. But practically that is not possible. Not possible in the sense practically it is not efficient to declare a stack where each cell is 1 byte. Okay. If you take any processor in the market right now, for example Intel, where Intel has stack where each cell or each item in the stack is 16 bits, that means 2 bytes. Your Motorola or ARM processor, there is a stack where each stack cell or each item in the stack is 4 byte, that is 32 bits. Okay, so that is very important. So 1 byte stack, what I explained in the example, that is not, I mean, that is not there in the market. Okay, practically it is not implemented. It is not wrong. I have explained you so that you can understand push and pop operations and you can understand how stack works. But practically it is not implemented in any of the processor. So if you take any processor where stack is implemented practically, either you find 2 byte stack, means I mean the every item in the stack or every cell in the stack is 2 byte, or most of the processor have stack where each cell or each item in the stack is 4 bytes. So I'll take this example now, 4 bytes, which is explained in your textbook. In your textbook or prescribed syllabus, the 1 byte stack operations are not explained. Okay, that is, I have explained to make you understand. Actually, in your textbooks or syllabus, they have explained a stack where each stack element is 4 bytes. So let me explain, I'll explain again all those push and pop operations in terms of 4 byte cell stack. Okay. So look at this stack carefully. Concentrate on the addresses of each cell. Okay, they are not continuous, but this entire stack is continuous. Okay, stack means a allocation of continuous memory. This stack starts from 1244H. Here, the right top boundary 1244H and continuously allocated till 1260H. That means stack is allocated from 1244H address up to here 1263H. 1263H. Okay. This is 4, right? Every cell here is 4 byte actually. Okay, we have taken a single cell, but it is actually 4 byte. So when it starts from 1244H, the byte 1244, 1245, 1246 and 1247, 4 bytes are allocated as one cell. So what is the next cell starts from this in stack? It is 1248H. Here 1248, 1249, 1 to 4A and 1 to 4B. All these hexadecimal byte addresses are allocated to this cell. So next is 1 to 4C. Similarly, when 1 to 6 0 starts the last cell, it is 1 to 6 0, 1 to 6 1, 1 to 6 2 and 1 to 6 3. 1 to 6 3H is the actually boundary of this stack. That is the bottom boundary. And the top boundary is 1 to 4 4H. So there are 32 different bytes here. 32 different bytes. Now how exactly we can calculate size of the stack? 32 bytes is the size of the stack, where each cell is 4 byte. Each cell is 4 byte. So how many items can be present here? 8. 32 divided by 4. Okay, so you can see here 8 different items. And look at the addresses carefully. This is how I explained. You can understand this, because every item here is 4 byte. So if one cell or item starts at 1250, so next item starts at 1254H. So this is how a 4 byte cell, each item 4 byte size, then the stack how it looks like. Okay. Here I have total 8 items in this. Okay. And each item is 4 byte. So totally 32 byte, that is the size of the stack. Fine. Now how push and pop operation works? I'll simply give one example. See, now SP is pointing to this address, isn't it? Because there are 4 items. You can see here, every hexadecimal digit I have mentioned here, the item inside the stack, are 8 digits are there. Why? One hexadecimal digit is 4 bit. 8 hexadecimal digit means 32 bit. I told you that this stack where each item is 32 bit. Correct, no? See, here you can see there is only 64H. That means it is only 1 byte. When you push 1 byte data into a stack where each item is must be 4 bytes, then remaining bits will be automatically adjusted to zeros. You can see here. So how push operation works? There are already 4 different data here. Now new item, whatever I push, it should be pushed to this topmost element as a topmost element at 1250H. But initially the address of SP is actually 1254H. So what we have to do to push a new element, since the size of every item is 4 byte here, you have to subtract the SP by 4. We were subtracting it by only 1 when the size of each cell in the stack is 1 byte. Now size of each cell in the stack is 4 byte. So if SP is pointing to 1254H date item, the item that has to be pushed newly, right, its address will be 1250H. You have to subtract by 4. Suppose, imagine there are items till here 1248H. Stack is filled up to 1248H. You want to push a new element here. What you have to do? You have to subtract stack by 4. You have to make 1248H address, that is SP pointing. You have to make SP value as 1244H. Then push into the that SP address. Are you getting this? Okay, if stack size where each item in the stack is 1 byte, each cell of the stack is 1 byte, then SP while pushing must be decremented by 1, subtracted by 1. If stack where each cell of the stack is 2 byte, then SP must be decremented by 2 while pushing. Here I have taken where stack each cell is 4 byte. So while pushing data, SP must be decremented by 4. Similarly, pop operation also works. In pop operation, we actually increment the stack pointer. No? See, SP is pointing to 1254H. I want to pop out this element, that is the topmost element. What happens if I pop out this element? Then SP must next point to 1258H. Means we have to add SP by 4. We have to add SP, right? We have to add 4 to the SP and increment it. So this is how happens in 4 byte cell size stack. Okay. Increment or decrement stack pointer, you have to do it by 4 value. Okay. So let us see the code actually. The same code I am giving that which I had given already. Okay, for 1 byte stack. Now I am giving same code here and making small changes. So this is a push operation for stack with where each cell is 4 byte. Okay. Now I have written the same code. Okay, but only the small difference is that, see, the code is similar. See, I am checking 1244H with the SP to handle overflow situation during push when stack is full. What is that? 1244H is the upper boundary or topmost boundary of the stack. Correct? Now, then I will check branch based on the condition situation whether stack is filled or not. And I will actually push the element if stack is not filled or stack is not full. That time I will actually subtract by 4. I will subtract SP by 4. That's the only difference. And then I will push my new item. Correct, no? If SP is pointing here 54, I will subtract by 4, make it 1250, and in that address I will push my new item. If stack is already filled, SP is pointing to the top boundary, it won't work. The overflow never happens because there is this condition. Similarly, this is a pop operation. Same, see, initially I am checking the lower boundary, that is 1260, lower boundary of the stack, bottom boundary of the stack with the SP value to check whether stack is empty. If stack is empty, I do not make pop operation. If stack is not empty, then I will make pop operation. Whatever the content, the topmost content is there, okay, it is copied to the destination, here move operation, and then since this is gone, that item is gone, next SP must point to the next element. That is, it was initially pointing to 1254H. Now it must point to 1258H. What you have to do? Add SP by 4. So this is how pop operation works. Now you might have a doubt how exactly auto increment and auto decrement works. Okay. In auto increment or auto decrement, while push, right? This is a push operation here and this is a pop operation. And while pushing, we make pre-increment. We increment SP, pre-decrement. We decrement SP initially and then push the new item. While popping out, we make post increment. Post increment in the sense we copy content from the stack initially, then increment the SP. But in previous example, the every cell in the stack was only 1 byte. So addresses must be incremented or decremented. It was working. So what about here when there is a stack with each cell is 4 byte? We have to actually decrement by 4 here and we have to actually increment by 4. But whether auto increment decrement works? Yes, it exactly works. That is the beauty of the auto increment decrement addressing mode. Wherever you use auto increment or decrement, the particular or respective value will be incremented or decremented by 1 only. But when you use same auto increment and decrement addressing with SP, that is a stack pointer, it automatically gets incremented or decremented by based on the each cell size of the stack. If my stack have every cell as 1 byte, then automatically SP and SP is either decremented by 1 or incremented by 1. Now in this previous slide I explained you stack where each cell in the stack is 4 byte. Now I can use same statement, no problem. Here automatically stack is decremented by 4 and incremented by 4. So auto increment decrement works like this only when that stack pointer register is used. Okay, this is the specialty of this. So you can effectively or efficiently use this auto increment decrement in the push and pop operation instead of subtract and addition instructions. So this is about the stack and its implementation using assembly language as well as the operations push and pop implementation. Thank you.